Have you ever had one of those dreams where you have that feeling that you're falling and it just shocks you awake, right? I mean, it's this frightening sensation, and of course for good reason, because I mean, every year millions of people get injured by falls, and most of those are not like from great heights or anything. I mean, all it takes is just a simple stumble or a slip, and the consequences can be painful. You know, it's tough. Our bodies are more fragile than we like to admit. And yet, you know, you watch movies and sports, and you see that there are some people out there who are just good at falling. You know, it's kind of funny. It's like an essential skill in some sports. I mean, we don't see it all that much in their final performance, but of course, gymnasts fall all the time in their training before they perform. And then there's football players, right? I mean, they get knocked down over and over again, and yet most of the time they manage to fall in such a way, at least between that and their pads and helmets, that they are able to shake it off and get back up again. It's just all part of the game. And so with all the ways that life knocks us down, we need to be good at falling, so to speak. Right? When we get tackled by times of suffering, we need to be able to respond well to it. Now, the Apostle Peter wrote the epistle of 1 Peter there in the New Testament to equip Christians for dealing with hard times. That's really the whole point of the letter. And a lot of the lessons in the book really apply with any difficulties that we face. And so we talked about in the first part of the book, Peter really focuses on the power of the hope of salvation. That's always there to encourage us as light in our darkest times. But as we get more into the middle of the book, he focuses specifically on preparing believers to face opposition to our faith. And so we've seen that at the end of chapter 3, he talks about about all that Jesus suffered and what he accomplished through his suffering. And then as he begins chapter 4, he tells us to adopt the same mindset as Jesus. We should be passionately devoted to fulfilling the church's mission that Christ gave to us. And he talks about it's part of it because we're living in the end times. That we just need to be ready to face opposition, to roll with the punches, so to speak, because that's part of the game. And so we come down to verses 12 through 19, and here it's kind of like Peter's wrapping up his argument a little bit. He's starting to wind down the letter, and he encourages Christians to respond to suffering in three ways. Now, he's already alluded to each of these earlier in the letter, so they should sound familiar to us. But he's reiterating them here to, you know, it's kind of like his conclusion. He's making them clear before he shares his concluding thoughts in chapter 5. Now, today, like I say, we've been talking a lot about suffering through this series, and so this isn't really anything new, but we still have to check our hearts and see whether we really are prepared to respond well in times when we face any kind of suffering, but particularly opposition to our faith. And so the first response that Peter talks about is to respond not with shock, but with joy. Now, I didn't serve in the military, but I assume that most people who do, when they enlist, they probably know something about what they're getting themselves into, right? I mean, their training is not going to be leisurely. They're not going to a resort. I mean, even if maybe a recruiter told them otherwise, you know, they shouldn't be shocked when they get there and find that the experience is intense and demanding because it's designed to transform them physically and mentally. And you know, we should have a similar expectation about following Jesus. I mean, it's the reality of the gospel, right? He was mocked. He was insulted. He was rejected and crucified. Why would we ever expect Christianity to be easy? But I think people do. I mean, there are some people who try to take the gospel as this promise of health, wealth, and success here and now. There's others, I think, that assume that if the church can exert enough power over society to kind of overrule opposition to win out, those views really misunderstand what the hope of the gospel is, that it's related to eternity and what the reality of following Christ in a fallen world is. And so Peter corrects our expectations here. We will face times of suffering. And when we do, we should respond, not with shock about it, but with joy. So 1 Peter 4:12, there Peter says, "Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you." Now, we often use the word surprise in a positive sense. Oh, surprise, right? But that's not the idea here. Some translations say, "Do not think it strange." We shouldn't think that it's weird or unusual to face suffering. We shouldn't be shocked when it comes our way. And Peter describes it here as a fiery ordeal, or literally a burning. I mean, that suggests that it'll be painful. But it also reminds us of something Peter said back at the beginning of the book, back in verses 6 and 7 of chapter 1. He was talking about the celebration of our hope, the hope of salvation. He says, "In this you rejoice, though now, for a little while if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." So when we went through that part of the book, we talked about that idea that fire purifies and refines gold. It demonstrates that it's genuine. And God uses trials to accomplish that same purpose in our lives. Right? He's transforming us spiritually. And that should lead to joy, but it's not a joy that's rooted in the pride of personal accomplishment of kind of, "Look what I did," you know, kind of like you might feel after surviving a military boot camp. No, our joy is based in our association with Jesus and in the anticipation of his return. And so you see that here in chapter 1, and then if we go back to chapter 4, verse 13, Peter says, "But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed." See, when we believe in Jesus, we're spiritually united with him. And so we see that truth throughout the New Testament. And Paul talks about it in places like Romans 6, where he talks about how we're united with Christ in his death, that he takes on our sins and pays the price for them. We're united with him in his resurrection. His resurrection power imparts eternal life to us. But that connection with him also means that we then, as his followers, become the target of the same hostility that was directed at him. That's all part of the deal. Right? Are you willing to accept that? Now, that opposition may come from people, but it may also come from spiritual forces. If you go back to the Old Testament book of Job, you really see that spelled out there. That Job faces, you know, verbal attacks from both his counselors and his wife. He faces physical violence. Thieves come and steal things, and even sickness and adverse weather, all of these things. And as hard as it is to suffer, the encouragement that we have, I think this is what Peter's getting at, is that when we suffer for the Lord, it confirms that we're on the right side, the winning side. Right? Our joy is not just that our suffering will one day cease and that we'll go to heaven. I mean, that is a great thing. But Peter really emphasizes this idea that to find joy that Jesus will return in glory, that he will assert his reign, that he will triumph over all opposition. And that means our faith in him will be publicly vindicated. That injustice will be set right. And so Peter calls us to set our hope on that event. And yet, it's not just something in the future. We're not left to fight this battle alone until then. And if we keep reading in 1 Peter 4, verse 14 says, if you are insulted for the name of Christ, you're blessed because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. As believers, we're never alone in our suffering. I mean, it may feel that way, but part of the good news of salvation is that God's Spirit dwells within us. If you go back to Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, as Peter preaches his sermon, that's really his main point. That those who repent and are baptized in the name of Christ receive forgiveness and, he says, the gift of the Holy Spirit. Even here in 1 Peter, back in verse 2 of chapter 1, Peter spoke of the sanctification of the Spirit. Right? And we talked about that at the time, that the Spirit helps us understand God's truth. He convicts us of sin so that to help us turn away from sin, to walk in holiness. And then he also comforts us and strengthens us. Jesus talked about him as the helper in John 14. And so we see in the book of Acts that when the early church experienced persecution, it was the Holy Spirit who gave them peace and empowered them to continue in ministry. Acts chapter 9, verse 31 says, so the church throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace and was being built up and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, it multiplied. Right? God worked through them as they were in suffering, as they were facing opposition and hostility. So all that to say again, don't be shocked when you experience suffering, right? It's part of following Jesus. Accept that in this fallen world. That's something we have to deal with. Now, as we do, we can draw upon the comfort of the Holy Spirit and we can find that joy in the hope, the anticipation of Christ's return in glory. Now, the second response to times of suffering is to respond not with shame, but with glory. You know, when you watch sports, some athletes are just really good at making the most of a penalty, right? I mean, you've seen the guys, they kind of perform for the referee, you know, where they fall down, they sprawl on the ground very dramatically, they get up, they stomp around, demand justice for this terrible offense committed against them. And of course, the reality is the officials can't see everything, and so sometimes that's all they see is the response. But, I mean, we know in professional sports, at least, there's cameras everywhere, and there's that instant replay that shows what really happened. Now, in the game of life, I think we see that there are some people that are very quick to claim that they're suffering for the Lord. And that's not always the case. But God is not some blind referee, right? To be fooled by someone's dramatic response. He doesn't need instant replay. He knows what's really going on. He knows the true source of our suffering. And so Peter offers up a warning here for believers to not let your suffering be rooted in shameful deeds, but in a life that's lived for the glory of God. So 1 Peter 4, verses 15 through 16 says, there Peter says this, but let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or as a meddler. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. So Peter starts with something that I think we'd consider obvious. Right? Murderers and thieves are probably not suffering in the name of Christ, right? First of all, I mean, their behavior calls into question whether they've come to repentance. But furthermore, they might claim to be persecuted, but their experience is almost certainly a consequence of some sort from their crime. So even if those consequences that they face are harsh, cruel, unjust, their suffering still doesn't come from a place of glorifying God, right? It comes from something that was shameful. Now, of course, as we think about situations like that, I mean, we all know the powerful slavery of sin. We should still have compassion upon people who have fallen into those kinds of sins, and we should, you know, present the gospel, offer them the hope of salvation, just like Jesus did when he was hanging on the cross with the thief next to him. He said, "Remember me when you come in your kingdom." And Jesus said, "Today you'll be with me in paradise." But getting back to our passage here, now it's no surprise that Peter takes that same view of suffering they talked about with murderers and thieves as he talks about the suffering experienced by evildoers. But that's a really broad term, kind of uncomfortably so, because to some degree it applies to all of us. I mean, no Christian should be an unrepentant doer of evil. Again, that would call into question whether or not they've really repented and are seeking to follow the Lord. But at the same time, none of us are sinless. And when we do succumb to temptation, sometimes there are painful consequences of that. And so in those cases, when we're suffering the consequences for sins that we've committed, we're not, you know, again, it's stemming from something shameful, not from living for the glory of God. Now, I think most of us recognize that distinction, that reality. But it's the fourth person mentioned in this list here that kind of comes as the shocker, surprise. Because Peter talks about the murderer, the thief, the evildoer, and then he just says, a meddler. Or the King James Version says, a busybody. Right? Literally, the word means talking about someone who's just always trying to oversee the affairs of others. Now, meddling is never explicitly defined as a sin in the Scripture. I mean, we could argue that maybe it's rooted in some sinful attitudes, certainly rooted in a sense of pride. And you think of the story of Job and his counselors and their mistaken advice about his suffering. It's arrogant to assume that you know how to fix everyone else's problems. And so even the most humble meddling is foolish. That's the perspective that we get upon it. Proverbs 26:17. Love this verse. It says, whoever meddles in a quarrel not his own is like one who takes a passing dog by the ears. In other words, when you meddle, you're bound to get bitten, right? There are consequences of being a foolish busybody because people tend to lash out at them. And when that happens, you can't say that you're suffering for being a Christian, that you're living for the glory of Jesus because you're doing something foolish that provoked that response. So that's interesting. We have to think about that. I mean, what about evangelism? Is evangelism a type of meddling? I don't think so. At least it shouldn't be. In evangelism, we invite people to believe in Jesus and to receive his forgiveness. If they're not interested in listening, I mean, Jesus told his disciples to sort of shake the dust off of their feet and move on to the next town, right? There was this sense of just accepting, okay, if someone's not ready to respond, all right. But meddling, on the other hand, I mean, it really comes down to sort of pestering people. Often from a moralistic standpoint, with do's and don'ts, it kind of tries to wear people down, to get them to conform to this standard. Now, I think it's safe to say that Satan's goal is to squelch evangelism, to squelch the preaching of the gospel. And one way to do that is overt persecution of Christians. But the alternative approach is to give Christians a degree of influence in society. Because when you look back over church history, I think what we see is that when the church, in those times when the church has some degree of power, it tends to drift away from evangelism and to focus on moralistic meddling. It ends up just calling people to be good. And the problem is that implies that they're able to do so. And that they, which then suggests that they really have no need for the gospel if they're able to be good. Right? I mean, the Bible's clear that apart from Christ, apart from salvation in Christ, we cannot do good. No one can. We are all sinners in need of salvation. And see, that creates a problem for that kind of moralistic meddling. Because when you keep picking at people, they become frustrated. And if they sincerely try to do good, they fail because they can't. They're in bondage to sin. And they feel conviction over their sin. But moralism offers no hope. It just keeps harping on, be good, be good. Live differently. And so how do people respond? Well, some may just reject the Christian view of morality. That's not, that moralism is not really Christian, but it's presented as such. But that still doesn't ease someone's conscience. And so sooner or later, they are inclined to lash out at judgmental meddlers to try to silence them. I think that's what Peter's getting at. As he says here, we shouldn't suffer as meddlers because that doesn't glorify God. It's a shameful thing if we're undermining the gospel in the way that we interact with unbelieving people. God's glorified when we faithfully proclaim the gospel of Christ in a humble way that reflects his compassion and grace. That's what it means to be a Christian. A follower of Christ. Now, again, just like we're talking about in this letter, Satan may still incite people to lash out at Christians who are faithfully preaching the gospel. That's the reality. But if they do, and we are being faithful, then our suffering becomes this, in a sense, an act of worship. We can respond as the apostles did, Acts chapter 5, verses 40 and 41 tells us when, it's talking about the Jewish council, when they had called in the apostles, they beat them and charged them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. And it says, then they, the apostles, left the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. Right? That's the mindset that we're talking about here. Don't provoke suffering through something that's going to result in shame. Glorify God by faithfully representing Jesus and his gospel. So, not shock, but joy. Not shame, but glory. And the third response that Peter talks about is not disobedience, but trust. Some people are really excited about the possibility of self-driving vehicles. But even if they ever get all the technical bugs worked out and the cars do drive perfectly, I'm not sure that anybody will ever accept them. Because I don't think we're just able to sit back and let the car do the driving. Because we would always be questioning its decision. Right? We certainly wouldn't be content with it driving the speed limit. We'd always want it to go faster. And bottom line is, we just like being in control. And I think we have the same problem with suffering. Because in those times when life gets hard, what do? We start questioning God's decisions. We start wanting to find some way to take control, to get this over as soon as possible. And the hard part is, in those moments, we might even just ignore God's commands It's in the attempt to find some relief from what we're going through. And so we need to sit back and let God drive, right? We have to, in those times of suffering, we have to respond not in disobedience, but in trust. And we just talked about a moment ago, Peter's referred to suffering as God's refining fire. But as he comes to verses 17 through 18, he takes the concept a step further. He relates it to God's judgment. Let's take a look. He says this: "For it's time for judgment to begin at the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if the righteous is scarcely saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner?" So we often think of God's judgment in connection with the return of Christ. And there's good reason to do that. That's a biblical idea. Jesus, Paul, Peter, John, Jude, they all talk about a coming day of judgment. But here, when Peter mentions judgment beginning with God's house, it brings to mind some of the teaching of the Old Testament prophets. In Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Ezekiel, when God's people disobeyed, remember, God brought nations against Jerusalem, where God's house was, the temple. Right? First, the Assyrians came, and then the Babylonians. And so God used those nations in that time of suffering to discipline his people. But in time, then, he also brought judgment upon those nations for their hostility toward his people. So I think Peter's envisioning the church undergoing a similar process. When we stray from the truth of the gospel, the Lord may use times of suffering and persecution to drive us back to it. I think you see that in the book of Acts. Because, you know, he talks about them going, preaching the gospel and being his witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea, Samaria, to the uttermost parts of the earth. And you read the first several chapters of Acts, and they just stay in Jerusalem. They don't seem to scatter. So what happens? Persecution. And persecution with Saul. And that persecution causes the church to scatter in Acts chapter 8. God is committed to his purpose. Right? And when we don't follow it, he's willing to poke us, to move us along. Now, a moment ago, I described evangelism as the communication of God's gracious invitation. But there is another side to that. It's also a proclamation of his holy command. Because the gospel demands a response. It demands repentance and faith. And that makes sense. You think about it. Jesus gave his life for us. To reject that is a slap in the face of God. And so it demands a response. But the fact of the matter is that even we as believers are prone to drift. And so here in verse 18, it's interesting, Peter quotes from the Greek translation of Proverbs 11:31, which is a little bit different than the Hebrew the original Hebrew that we see in our Bibles, our translations of that verse. But anyway, Peter quotes the Greek, and it says that the righteous are scarcely saved. It's that idea that I think, again, it's not because of anything in us. Right? Our salvation is entirely of God's grace. Now, he has no trouble doing that, but at least on our end, it looks like we're barely eking through. I mean, the Lord provides for it through sending his son, and he graciously uses sometimes the hard times, right? These times of suffering to keep us on the path. And so that proverb asks, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? I mean, they'll face something far worse than a little temporary suffering, right? It's a frightening thought, and yet it doesn't have to be because of the gospel. Because we are invited to believe in Jesus and to receive forgiveness for our sins. And so we need to humbly place our life in God's hands. It's interesting how Peter says that here. 1 Peter 4:19, he finishes the chapter saying, "Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good." Seems to me sometimes when people go through times of suffering, they really kind of get wrapped up in trying to figure out why. Why me? You know, why is this happening? And I mean, you look back at Job, and that's what his counselors are doing. They're trying to speculate on why, and they keep coming back to, "Well, you must have done something wrong, Job." I think in a way, when we do that, it's like trying to gain some sense of control, that at least if I know what's going on, then I have some control over the situation. But Peter kind of calls us to do the opposite here. It's giving up control, accepting that whatever suffering I encounter, that it must be according to God's will because he's allowed it to come into my life. And then Peter says, entrust your soul to him. He's our faithful Creator. Just give it over. Trust him with it. I know that's not easy to do, right? But and then this is the kind of the stinger at the end. Do good. Turn from sin, walk in obedience, show kindness even when people are being hostile toward you. Because that's what we see in Jesus. In Luke's gospel, in the account of Christ's crucifixion, it says this, Luke 23:33-34, when they came to the place that is called the skull, or Calvary, right? There they crucified him and the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And they cast lots to divide his garments. I mean, that's really the heart of the gospel in the face of suffering. He's praying for the salvation of those who just stripped off his clothes and drove spikes through his hands and feet. If we believe in him, we should follow that example of suffering. Respond not in disobedience, but in trust. Full, complete trust. So that's a high standard, isn't it? How are we doing in responding to suffering? Remember these responses. Don't be shocked by it. Find joy and hope in Christ's return. Draw comfort from the presence of the Holy Spirit. Live in such a way that your suffering doesn't become a matter of shame, but of living for the glory of God. And then rather than disobeying the gospel, entrust your soul. And that doesn't just mean the inner part, but your whole life. Entrust your whole life fully to the Lord. I know there's a tendency sometimes to fall into just thinking of faith as the acceptance of some beliefs. And while that's certainly true, saving faith also includes a sense of surrender, which I think is that last verse in 1 Peter 4 gets at so well. We have to entrust ourselves to him. Have to trust God, not only just to save us for eternity, but to guide us through life now and even through all the challenges and trials. And so if you've never done so, I encourage you to entrust your soul to the Lord. Because like Peter says, he's faithful. If you want to learn more about his faithfulness, about his power, his sovereignty, his love, Romans chapter 8 would be a great place to follow up on that, to read more. Now, maybe this passage has brought to mind some area of sin in your life. Don't wait for God to bring some kind of discipline. Turn away from that behavior. Do good. Follow the example of Jesus in his suffering and in his proclamation of the gospel. And again, people may be hostile, but we should accept the possibility of suffering for Jesus. May we walk by faith and grow in Christ-likeness. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much for the great hope of the gospel, for the hope of salvation, for this amazing truth of your Spirit being present with us and in us. And Lord, I pray that we wouldn't grieve the Spirit, but that we would respond with humility, and that we would be teachable, growing in holiness and purity and Christ-likeness, growing in love. Father, even when we face hard times, and Lord, you know the trials, the difficulties that we each are facing. And so for those who are worn out and tired today, Lord, I pray that you would strengthen them and encourage them. Lord, for any of us who are just complacent, I pray that you would wake us up. Lord, if we're angry and wanting to fight back, I pray that you would help us to come to this sense of faith and trust in you. Lord, help us to represent the gospel faithfully in our life and in our words. And we thank you, Lord, for the great hope of Christ's return. We pray for his kingdom to come, for him to rule and reign in power and glory. In his name.